We all say we want to have a blessed life, but what does that really mean? Is it simply having a nice car, a big house, new clothes? What if a blessed life isn't what you think? What if it's more about what you give away than what you hold on to? What if it's more about the contents of your heart than the contents of your bank account? How do we really live the blessed life?
Okay, we're beginning a new series today called The Blessed Life, and I'm really excited about it. And I know that's going to be a great series. Why is it a great series? Because we're going to be opening on the Word of God, and God has a lot to say about being blessed. And I want to let you know this is not going to be a prosperity gospel message, in case you're wondering what that means. If you grew up like me, maybe you experienced. I grew up in the 1970s and 80s, the great, best decade in the world. The 80s were awesome. Anyhow. But during that time, there's some bad doctrine that got around. It was called prosperity gospel, and it, blab it and grab it, confess and possess. It was all about what you can get out of God. And God was a big slot machine in the sky. You just got to throw some money in it, pull the lever, and bam, baby, you're going to be blessed. And that's what people taught, and I got so tired of it that it got to the point where I almost went to the opposite extreme. I didn't want to talk about it. It's like someone that's been abused. My brother has a dog, Glenn, called Katrina, and it was from what do you call that place in Louisiana where the floods were? New Orleans, right, where the Duck Dynasty guys are, okay, in that area. And this dog was like the most depressed dog. The dog's on suicide watch. It walks around, and you get all scared, and if you raised your hand, it would run away. If it rained, it would run underneath the bed. Why? Because it was abused, and it was scared. And in many ways, I was the same way in regards to the issue of giving and prosperity, because I'm like, I don't want any of that stuff. I'm so sick to death of it. But thank God that I got delivered of that, and I found out that it is often the enemy will distort what's the most important. And if he can distort and make it look bad and keep you away from either have you go the extreme where it's all about you, or go to the other extreme, run away from it, then guess what? Both people are not getting it. But God has, he wants to bless us. And I want to encourage you, I'm not shy to say that today. And we're going to be talking about that. In fact, I want to just let you know that I had the great opportunity to meet Pastor Robert Morris and had a chance to spend a little time with him. And I had some associates and friends of mine, and we talk. And so the first service, we gave away these books, and we have none left. So next week, we get a whole other shipment. Who would like to have a book? The bowl will get it. There you go. And I have another one here, just in case. My name's it. Who else wants a book this morning? Okay, Shelly's got raising her hand. I can't help it. And she's got a cool bike to top it off. There you go. But great book. This book has really shaped me a lot in regards to that, because it really brought balance to what I believe. And if you haven't grown up in all that, count yourself blessed. There's a lot of junk that has happened through the church, through that kind of thing. But today we're going to talk about how to be a blessed, how to have a blessed life. God wants you to be blessed. I mean, what parent doesn't want their child to be blessed? Can you imagine having children? We're going to have children. We're going to make their life miserable. We don't want them blessed. Of course. I mean, that's the joy of Christmas. Well, the joy of Christmas is Christ coming to earth. But another joy is the little kids in their pajamas getting up at 2 o'clock in the morning, waiting to see what's under the tree, right? All excited, birthdays, gifts, and presents. We love to see our kids happy. Well, we're made in the image of God, and God loves to see us happy too. But he doesn't want us happy living a lie. He wants us happy in the truth. And so today we're going to bring some balance to this whole thing called a blessed life. Blessing comes from a giving heart. So we're going to look at it right now. And I want to start off with one of the most famous verses on this. It's found in Matthew 7, verse 1 and 2. It says this: "Judge not that you not be judged. For with the judgment you judge, you'll be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you." Right? Have you heard it before? I heard people preach on this and make it all about money. Is it saying anything about money here? What is it about? Judgment, right? It's about judgment, about measuring, right? You give someone, if you're mean to somebody else and you don't give someone grace, God won't give grace to you. So it's pretty serious. And so we look at a parallel passage of that as well. It's found in Luke 6, which is more famous. And a parallel passage is simply this, the same type of verses and teaching that Jesus gave, but given by a different author that also did all the research and is writing this. This is from Luke. Okay, so this is the parallel passage. It says this, judge not, and you'll not be judged. I mean, the world loves to quote this one. Everyone, even atheists quote this one. Judge not, and you shall not be judged. Condemn not, and you shall not be condemned. Forgive, and you'll be forgiven. If you don't forgive, you won't be forgiven. It's serious stuff. Well, watch what happens next, okay? This is the context. The context is judgment, is it not? Okay, so now we go to the next verse. Give, and it'll be given to you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over will be poured into your bosom, for with the same measure that you used, it will be measured back to you. What's the context of this? The context is judgment, not money. Now, I wish it was money because it would be preached as well, but it's not about money. It's about judgment. However, there's a principle here. The principle is the law of reciprocity, or sowing and reaping. And so what you give, you'll get back. My son Matthew, who's not feeling well this morning, he hurt his leg. I don't know where he is. He's at the, I want to pray for my son Matthew. Is that be okay, guys? He hurt his leg, and he's at the ER right now. I don't know what's going on with him. So I want to pray for him. My wife is with him. And so, Father, I just thank you so much for my son Matthew. I love him so much. God, I just pray you touch his left leg, whatever's causing it to have this pain. We ask if it's a fracture, whatever it is. We pray that healing would come upon him, and he'd be back here running around where I have to chase him again. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So give, it'll be given to you. Good measure, pressed down. What they used to do, by the way, used to go get some rice or something, or beans. They get it and they'd shake it. You know how you shake something, get more in? When I was a kid, I used to do that with my bowl of cereal. I get my Frosted Flakes. I want to shake and get more in there. So my brothers did not get it. You shake it, and then what do? You get more. You pour it into your lap. And so what he's basically saying is, give, it'll be given to you. Good measure, running over, will be poured into your bosom. For with the same measure that you use, it'll be measured back to you. Okay, so the Bible's very, very clear about this principle. And see, God's nature is giving. God's nature is giving. God doesn't just give, he is given. He gives. It's personality, it's his attribute. God's nature is giving. How do you know that? Well, for God so what? Loved the world that he what? Gave. The whole essence of the gospel of Jesus Christ, what has gone around the world from Jerusalem 2,000 years ago, is wrapped around the whole world, is what? It's all about giving. You cannot talk about Christianity without giving. People ask me, you ever preach on giving? He said, yes, every time I get up, I preach about giving. It may not be about money, but it's about giving, because giving is what God's all about. It's giving. All right, so God's nature is giving. And if we want to be like God, we got to get his nature. Because you and I are called to give. We're not called to take. Your name's not Jimmy, Gimme, Gimme. My name is Jimmy, Gimme, Gimme. Okay, a lot of people live that way. It's not about give me, my name is Jimmy. It's about I want to be a blessing to other people. Do not be deceived, it says in Galatians 6:7. God is not mocked. There's a principle. It's called the law of gravity. The law of gravity will not be mocked. You jump off the top of this building, you're going to break your leg. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man, what? Sows, that he will also reap. Matthew, once again, I'm using an example because I love the five-year-old. So cute. You're cute too, Luke, but you're getting handsome now. And Hannah's beautiful. Okay, but we had an apple. He said, I want an apple tree, Dad. I'm like, okay. So he took an apple. He went to see seeds. Let's go in the backyard. He dug in the one place where the grass is growing, he decided to dig a hole there. And he put the seeds in, and he's been watering. He's waiting for an apple tree. He said, Dad, where's the apple tree? I said, well, wait, it's going to take a while. So every day he goes out there and waters it. Why? Because he believes. What happens with that apple seed? When I'm 80 years old and my grandkids are around me, there'll be a nice big apple tree out there. But what happens? You take one seed and it multiplies, and one seed you have many, many apples. So do not deceive. God is not mocked. Whatever a man sows, he will reap, and it will multiply. Sometimes, I'm Italian a little bit, okay, and I'm some kind of German, and sometimes I've noticed that my children, I'm sorry, Luke, some of my children kind of raise their voice too much. Dad, I don't want to do it. Dad, I can't. So why are you yelling at me? Why are you yelling? Oh. So I'm getting back what I've given. Okay? No, please don't call DCF on me, okay? All I'm trying to say is, that I get back sometimes. If you don't like what you're getting, look at what you're giving. If you're not getting respect from anybody, and everyone's negative and everyone's mean to you, there could be a problem. I heard of a story of a gentleman that had some cheese, and he ate some cheese, and it smelled really bad. It was feta cheese, and he's walking around. He says, "Everything stinks around here. Everything smells." He's walking around, and the reason why, he's got feta cheese in his beard. So he takes a stink with him. And so many times, if you will be stinky, everything you do will be stinky, and whatever do not be received, whatever a man or woman sows, that he or she will also reap. So this is a principle. Now, Jesus said something very, 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 very important for us. It is something that you can base your life upon and how you judge your life and how you look at your life. He says the following: do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth. Now, he's not saying that we live in mud huts in the mountain someplace. He says, but do not lay up for yourself treasures on earth. Why? Where moth and rust, it should say taxes, it doesn't say that, and destroy, and where thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. So we've got treasures. The desire to have treasures is not a bad thing. You want to enjoy nice things. God has made us to enjoy nice things. But why do you want to enjoy nice things that are gone when you can have things that never go away? All right? So, but lay up for yourself treasures in heaven where neither moth or rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal, and it's not taxed. That's even better. They can't get it from you. Isn't that nice? Whatever you do for God is both here and now and forevermore. Now, this is the next part I want you to get. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. I never cared about Apple stock until you bought some, right? And you buy some stock, all of a sudden you got the notification. Every time it moves, where's my stock? Why? Because you have invested money. Where your money is where your heart is. And so you don't care about stock until you put money into it. You don't care about something until you put something into it. So where your treasure is, there's your heart will be also. So if your treasure isn't getting things and trying to, you know, get a better, listen, there's nothing wrong with a better car, better house, better vacation, nothing wrong with those things, but that's all you're living with, guess what your heart's gonna be after? Those things. And you know what happens sometimes? Sometimes God allows those things to be taken from you. I didn't realize this. I mean, this happened to me recently. Something was taken from me, and it made me feel uncomfortable. I said, whoa, wow, God, I was relying on that. Man, I'm so sorry, God. I got to rely on you, not that. And so it's a blessing. We are to rely on God, not things or people. God is our strength. God is our source. And as long as we make it about people and not him is a problem. The people are made in his image are important. For where your treasure is, your heart will be also. So giving is all about the cardia, the heart. And the heart is the epicenter of all that you are. When the Bible talks about your heart, it means everything. It means your cardia, heart in Greek, okay? If you want your heart connected to God's kingdom, then you put your treasure there. Where your treasure is, your heart will be. And so if I'm more interested in buying another guitar or another car, and I'm not thinking about how to expand the kingdom, there's something wrong. Because it's not about that. If I'm about, I got to grow the church so I can go to the pastor's meeting and brag how big the church is, that's the wrong motive. But if I say, God, I want the church to grow because there's people out there that are dying or going to hell without you. God, we got to grow the church. That's a totally different thing. Where's my heart? On God's will. Now, am I going to lie to you and say sometimes I do like to go to the pastor's meeting and go, yeah, wait a minute. That's humanity. That's carnal. In Jesus' name, I'm not going to do that. I'm doing it for God. And what happens when it's about me? I get anxious. When it's about God, I get bold. When it's about me, I get anxious. When it's about God, I get bold. Why? Because God's going to have to show up to make this one happen. Giving is all about the heart. Well, how do you build a blessed life? You see, a blessed life is a state of mind, a state of spirit, more than it is a state of a bank account. How to build a blessed life? Build a giving heart towards God. That's the only way, my friends, because the gospel is all about giving. God could have given the universe. He could have given us planets. He could give us gold. He could give us wonderful things, but he didn't do that. He gave himself. And I've seen families growing up, and I grew up one time. I was growing up in a household, and I had some friends of mine, and one of my friends, I'll call him John. That wasn't his name. And John, unfortunately, his mother was divorced, and the parents were trying to buy him. So he had all the best stuff. He had ColecoVision, Atari. He had all the cool stuff. He had the $6 million man dolls and Oscar Goldman and all these cool, I'm dating myself here, had all these cool dolls and toys. I loved to go to his house, but he was the saddest and the most pathetic person because his parents were throwing things at them instead of himself. Well, God doesn't do that. God gives his best. He gave Jesus. And so freely you have received, now freely give. So how to build a blessed life? Build a giving heart towards God. Now, we're going to go to the Old Testament because this really demonstrates from the Old Testament standpoint, which goes right to the New Testament, attitude of heart and how God deals with it, okay? So just bear with me as we read it together in Deuteronomy 15, 7 through 8. And this is Moses speaking now to the Israelites through God. If there is among you a poor man of your brethren, can you do me a favor? I did this first service. Could you shut that shade? It's reflecting on the screen. I'm having a hard time seeing the scripture. I'd appreciate that. Thank you. I'm losing my voice. Thank you, sir. I'm so thankful for my son. Okay. Aren't you happy I'm losing my voice? I can't yell at you later on. So let me scream here in church. Okay. If there's among you a poor man, your brethren within any of these gates in your land, which the Lord your God has given you, you shall not, what? Harden your heart. Ah! How do you harden your heart? By shutting your hand. When there's needs, and you can meet it, and you ignore it, your heart gets hard. When you walk down the street, someone sent in a cardboard, I know a lot of those folks are in, I get it. There are a lot of people on drugs, and they're going to buy alcohol. I understand that. But you should ask the Lord, Lord, what should I do about this person at the corner? You know, what's happening here? You should not harden your heart. And this is the brethren. This is people in the church. He says, listen, if we can't do it here, we can't do it out there. So we got to practice. That's why you practice worship here, so you can do it out there. All right? So, you shall not harden your heart or shut your hand from your poor brother, but you shall open your hand wide to him and willingly lend him sufficient for his need, whatever he needs. Now, there are people out there that take advantage of the system, and you don't want to enable them. We're not suggesting that. I'm talking about responsible giving. Irresponsible giving is just, here, have it. No, you need to know what you're investing in and if the person's, okay? But nevertheless, building a life of blessing, deal with a selfish heart. The problem is you and I have a selfish heart. No, I am. Yes, you are. All we have to do is pipe in the nursery right now. I guarantee you, in the nursery, there's this obscure toy in the corner. And some child is going to decide to touch some old toy. He's going to go over and touch it. And the next thing you know, the whole classroom is there. Let me have that. Mine. And you're arguing about it. And then little Johnny says, I'm taking this down. And little Johnny goes to another obscure toy and picks it up. The whole class wants it. I don't want to miss. I am selfish. Listen, it is a default setting. It takes no work. You don't have to go to college to learn to be selfish. You don't have to be Republican or Democrat to be selfish. All you have to do is all of you are valedictorians of your class in selfishness. We're all experts in it. We all have doctors and PhD degrees, multiple degrees. Why? Because selfishness comes easy, takes no effort. All you have to do is nothing, and you'll be selfish. It's just the way it works. Deal with a selfish heart. My name is Jimmy, gimme, gimme. That's a selfish heart. I want it my way, okay? I have to have it my way. It's so easy. When you're building a life of blessing, you got to deal with a selfish heart. Now, this is the same passage of Scripture. We just read the first couple of verses. Now we're going to verse 9. Beware lest there be a wicked thought in what? Your heart, saying, the seventh year, the year of release. Now, what is that? Well, in the Old Testament, a wonderful thing they had a year of Jubilee. They have 7 years. And after 7 years, if you had any debts, it was paid. Wouldn't that be nice? Don't you wish that the new administration would do that? We should probably send someone up to Trump Tower and get him to do that. Wouldn't that be cool if Pastor passed a rule? And by the way, we need to be praying for that new administration, by the way. They're trying to pick people. So Lord, help them pick the right people in Jesus' name. Amen. Imagine that, where every 7 years, all your debt was gone. Isn't that pretty cool? That's what happened back then. So I want to buy this guy's house. And so I need to borrow $100,000 to buy this house. But 2 weeks from now, it's the year of Jubilee, so it's all mine. So what they would do sometimes, and they had these laws where they would adjust the price based upon the year of Jubilee. But the Bible's saying here, just because that's coming doesn't mean you stop giving, even if you end up losing on the deal. All right? Beware lest there be a wicked thought in your heart saying, the seventh year, the year of release is at hand, and your eye be evil against your poor brother, and you give him nothing, and listen to this one, and he cry out to the Lord against you, and it becomes sin. Selfishness becomes sin. The biggest problem in a marriage is selfishness. The biggest problem in churches is selfishness. The biggest problem in companies is selfishness. The biggest problem in politics is selfishness. I want to have it my way. It's not Burger King. It's the Lord's way. Wrong king. We serve the King of Kings. Well, you don't have it your way. You have it his way. And so it's very important that we understand that it's not about us. It's about him. So what happens is when you get selfish, it turns to wickedness. You want to read the progression? Open James chapter 4 and read it. It shows the whole progression of how sin bursts into death. So, why did God create giving? Why? Well, because, you know, the church has needs, and, you know, we bring money, and you guys do the work, and we support, and you do. No, that's not the reason why. Totally the reason why. In fact, do you know that God doesn't have to pay his electric bill? He's fine. He's got a cattle on a thousand hill. That's not the reason why totally God wants us to give so we can do stuff, as if we're going to lend God something. That's the reason why. That's not the reason why, by the way. There's another reason why he creates giving. Why is that? We give not to get, but to love God by giving. If you come today, right now, you give $1,000 and you'll get $10,000 back. And they show some lady sitting there on food stamps, and you can barely pay her bill, got a dialysis with a dialysis machine. She says, I called in and I gave $20 to the guy. And the next thing you know, she's driving a Bentley. And that's not how it is, okay? And then they say, call right now and give me a dollar. Or even the pastor will say the same thing. Give God $100, give you $1,000 back. You know what that is? That's paganism. You know what that is? Prostitution. Oh, you're paying God to get something that you want so you can have your way. That's what you call prostitution. How can you say that, Pastor? That's sacrilege. Well, all you have to do is read the Old Testament, where Israel would prostitute themselves to Moloch, to Baal, to the foreign gods. Why? Because they wanted to have it their way. My friend, that's manipulation. We do not manipulate God. And God forbid we get that. And so if we train you to give so you can get, guess what's going to happen if you don't get exactly what you want? You're going to pout, and you're going to go home. You say, I don't believe God anymore. It doesn't work. Well, it isn't about that. You see, it's not about that. We love God by giving. Now, I'm going to get myself into trouble again, but that's okay. I do that here all the time. That's why you guys come. But there's a situation. Imagine, if you will, if you're married, and I'm going to use a man. All the man cares about is, you know what? I don't have to say it, but you know what I'm talking about. Oh, she's got to be a woman. She should be, you know. Meanwhile, you come home all smelly. But you want to make sure that she's going to produce for you. You're going to have, you know what? And if you go home and that's all you care about, your wife, all I care about is I get some, what kind of marriage would that be? It's not going to last. However, if you love your wife, you give grace to your wife, you do the dishes, You blow the leaves. You put the kids to bed. You get up when the baby's crying. You'll be smiling in church. Anyhow, well, listen, what I'm trying to say is this. Real intimacy comes from a real giving relationship. When I love God, you get blessed back. Why? Because God is made giving. And when we give, we become like God. And what happens is you're designed to give. You're designed to receive and to give. And when you do that, you get blessed. So we give not to get, but love God by giving. I'm going to give an example here. Since, who could I pick on today? I'm going to pick on Jeff with one F. Jeff with one F. I'm sorry, Jeff. Come on up. That's how I remember his name, by the way. I forgot his name. Hope you don't mind, Jeff. Okay? I'm going to give you an example. Imagine this is like money or something. Okay? Come on up. That's okay. I don't bite. All right? So this is what I'm going to do the first time. Okay? First thing I want you to do is when we're going to talk, I want you to try to grab some of these papers while I'm talking to you. I'm going to do the same. Ready? Here we go. I just want to... give me that. Okay. Okay. Got it? Okay. Now, both of us are trying to get. We're being leechy. Now what I want to do is I want to try to give him. Well, okay, so Jeff, how you doing? Jeff, here, take some of this. Here, man. Give some to me, too. Come on. Okay. Hey, thanks, man. Hey, wow. What's happening here? There's an exchange. Thank you. You can go. You can sit down now. You can have this, by the way. All right. That's Jeff with one F. All right. Listen, what just happened there? What just happened is very simple. You saw what happened. When you have two leeches sucking, what happens? You deplete each other. And you get exhausted. If you go in a relationship and the people exhaust you, you just walk out, you're depleted. What would happen if you go in to try to give and the other person gives? Both of you are built up. That's the way God has designed us. And by the way, not all of us have the same gifts. You can do stuff I can't do. Like Jeff, for example, I'm picking on Jeff. He's like really organized and procedure-based, and he's really... And so I'm not, if you know me. And so what happens is he can compliment me, and I can... I don't know if I can compliment him or not, but hopefully I could. And so what happens, he brings something, and I bring something to him. So I give, and he gives. Instead of saying, well, you're not... You should be more this way. You should be more this way. Instead of trying to grab from each other, let me give him the blessing of what I have, and he let me give the blessing of what I have, and we're mutually benefit. That's what church should be. We should be completing each other, not competing against each other. In fact, we just happen to have a class today right after the service called Step 3, Discovery, where you can find out how God's wired you, and you can find out how you're wired and how you can develop and use your gifts right here. And that's how you grow. You grow by giving what God has given you. Today, right after the service, 12:30, right-hand side, we have free food, we have extra food, and childcare. You can't go wrong. We got a couple places for you. Okay, that's what's happening today. That's why we do what we do. We believe we complete each other. We do not compete against each other. So you try to bless somebody. What happens if you try to do that? I like what my son Luke went to bar mitzvah yesterday, and I was hearing about what happened, and they're talking about the young man and how he opens the doors for people, and he's a blessing to other people. Listen, we should be a blessing wherever we go. We should make a place better. So we give not to get, but to love God by giving. Blessing comes by being thankful to God. Thanksgiving. You have to give something to be thankful. Thanksgiving. Well, I want to thank God. We're sitting in a room that's air-conditioned or heated or whatever it is, right? You got clothes on your back. You got food in your stomach. And you have options in your life. You have first-world needs, not third-world needs. Worrying about your next, what you're going to eat next. Some of you are still worrying about that. Relax, okay? Blessing comes by being thankful to God. Thanksgiving. In everything, give thanks. Why? For this is the will of God. So if you want to learn to be a benevolent person and be blessing, you must be a thankful person. An ungrateful person does not attract the Spirit of God. It attracts the spirit of complaint, and the spirit of complaint is the enemy. Thanksgiving is something that, what it does, it attracts God. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. It's being thankful. Well, how do you build a blessed life? Build a giving heart towards God and deal with a grieving heart. What's a grieving heart? Well, let me explain to you. Back to the same passage of Scripture. Here we are again, continuing with the same passage. You shall surely give to him and your heart should not be grieved. Johnny, share it with Susie. Oh, gee. Here you are. Or how about this? How about this? How about you buy fries for your kids? Okay, you buy fries, and Five Guy fries. They're awesome, all right? And you buy that. Nine. And they grab it. I bought you the fries. Give me some fries. No. I want the ones even in the bottom of the bag. Those are my fries. I bought them, right? I don't like to share my food, by the way. Okay, I don't. Women like to share food. I don't know what it is. I buy something. Can I have some? I'll buy you a whole potato farm, but these are my French fries. No. Okay, anyhow. So you should surely give to him, and your heart should not be grieved when you give it to him, because for this thing the Lord your God will bless you in all your works and in all which you put your heart. You should not be grieved. You should not be grieved. If you learn to give with the right heart, God will bless you. You know, can I have a little rabbit trail for a second? I just realized I have to go out to eat. I don't know. I forgot to bring money with me. Note to self. What? What do you want? Well, we're.
I want to bless you.
Are you serious?
I want to be a blessing. Is that cool?
Come on. Really?
Oh, yeah, I have some money here.
How much?
I'm going to give him all the money I have.
How much is that?
This is $100.
Hey, I'm going to go out and have a good time.
Take your family out.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. Well, isn't that awesome? Well, I got news for you. I gave him the money beforehand. Now, was it hard for him to give the money away? No. Why? Why wasn't it not hard for Rick to give it away? Because why? What did I do? What did I do? I gave him what? I gave him the money beforehand. So what happens? He realizes it's not his. It's mine. So he just handed it back to me. So tithing is not in the Bible. Well, I have good news and bad news for you. The good news in the Old Testament, tithing was you need to do it. In the New Testament, you know what New Testament is? God owns it all. So you go back to the Old Testament. I'm living in the New Testament. It's all God's, okay? And so what happens here? I'm not going to grieve because it's not mine. It's God's. And so if you feel yourself grieving, and if there's like a chain on your wallet and you have a hard time passing out the dough, chances are you're thinking it's yours. It's not yours. It's God's. When our children were born, my wife and I, after I cut the umbilical cord, that was kind of gross, but I did that. And still getting over that. I said, Lord God, we hand them back to you. They're on loan from you. Selfishness attacks us before we give, and grief after we give. Right? Oh, man, I just gave that away. Oh, man, I didn't want to give that away. You ever go through that? You give something to somebody, oh, I shouldn't have done that. Oh, that hurts. And then something breaks. Well, the pastor said, if I give, I'll be blessed, and I'm not blessed anymore. What's going on? Well, we'll continue with that next time. But the reason we grieve is because we thought it was ours. It's not yours. It's not yours at all. In fact, when we give back to God and realize it's already his, we won't grieve. So if you grieve when you're giving, you think you own it. You don't own it. How can you say that? Well, so glad you asked. Because do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God? And you are what? You're not your own. For why? For you were bought at a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are yours, God's. Listen, if you gave your life to Christ, your life's not your own. Not even 10%, it's 100%. Your life's not your own. Your breath's not your own. Your body's not your own. I can do what I want. It's my body. No, it isn't. It's been bought with a price. Well, I don't like that. I'm in control of my own life. Well, if you're not for God, guess who has control over you? The enemy. Listen, you are bought with a price. I don't have the right to tell God what he's going to do in my life. Neither do you. And you know the funny thing is, when you do it God's way, it works. Ultimately, it works. There's peace, there's joy, and no one can kill that. Even if you're martyred, you can't kill that, as we learned last week. When you give to God and you realize it's all his, you begin to resonate the frequencies of God's heartbeat, and your heartbeat becomes His. And His blood is in your veins, and you become an outstretched arm of God from heaven. What would happen if our church would become more like that? Well, the heartbeat of God would be us. How to build a blessed life? Build by giving a heart. Build a giving heart towards God. Deal with a grieving heart and develop a generous heart. How do you develop a generous heart? Well, Deuteronomy, same passage of Scripture. You shall supply him liberally. Well, I'm conservative. Tough. You gotta be liberal when it comes to giving, okay? From your flock, from your threshing floor, and from your wine press, from what the Lord has blessed you with, all right? You shall be give to him. We are blessed to be a blessing. Can you guys stick with me a little bit? I'm gonna finish this up, all right? I know we passed the time, but we had a little fun today in worship. So I want to finish this up. We are blessed to be a blessing. It's crummy outside anyhow. Now, this is something very important. Listen to me. God wants you to be blessed. Look at your neighbor, says God wants to be blessed. Yeah. What does that mean, Pastor? Well, let me explain to you what that means. I'm so glad you asked once again. I love these rhetorical questions. Okay. We are blessed to be a blessing. Why? Because the essence of Christianity, God's interaction with mankind, came through a man by the name of Abram, who became Abraham. And this is the truth. If you and I will get, I pray this over my children almost every day, and I pray it over myself too. Listen to this. This is a promise, by the way. I will make you a great nation. In the Greek Septuagint, is ethnos, which is a people group. God will make you a great people group. Listen, my grandfather, both grandfathers gave their life to Jesus Christ. My mother got saved. My dad got saved later on. And now I'm second generation preacher, okay? Second generation follower. And I'm praying my family, as for me and my house, they're gonna serve God too. And we're gonna create a legacy of God, a new ethne, a new people group. Even if you don't have children, you can influence people where they follow your influence, and you can become a nation builder, a people builder. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you. God wants to bless you. Look at your neighbor and say, God wants to bless you. God wants to bless you. Who, me? Yes, you. God wants to bless you. Why? I will bless you and what? Make your name great. God wants you to be great. Yes, he wants you to be great. Why? And you shall be a blessing. It doesn't say you can think about it. No, you're going to be a blessing. When you go someplace, it should be better than when you're not there. If there's a door there and there's a lady there or somebody or even a guy, open the door. You're making it better for somebody. If you're waiting to get a haircut and there's a seat and someone walks in, get up and give them your seat. You make it, what's that? If you're faithful in the small, be faithful in great. Listen, you shall be a blessing. When you go to your job place, I'm going to do the best in a job. Why? So I can get a promotion? Not necessarily, but because I want to be a blessing. Listen, the church should be the best. The Jewish people understand this. On Friday night, they lay their hands on their children and say, you are blessed, and they speak blessing. Generation after generation after generation, they believe that. And what happens? It gets written to their DNA code. It gets written in their genetics, both spiritually and even genetically. Behavior is written, by the way. Your behavior writes your genetic code. I don't know if you realize that. That's another time. But they pass that on, and God's blessings on them. Why is it 3% of the population of the world, something small, and they're the greatest scientists, the greatest musicians, from Jerry Seinfeld to Albert Einstein, right? Why? Because they know they're blessed, whether they realize it or not. You and I should be the best at everything. Why? Because we have the blessing of God on us. I will make you a great nation. God wants to make us a great church. We want excellence here. Why? Because God's excellent. He's excellent. I will bless you. God wants to bless this church. He wants to bless you and make your name a blessing, and you will be a blessing. Listen, we don't have an option just to build a nice church and have a good time. We're supposed to be a blessing to people outside. We're supposed to be a blessing to people that don't have enough. We're supposed to be a blessing around the world. He blesses us so we can be a blessing. And God looks down, and if he sees someone that says, those are my fries, why is God going to give you more fries if you say you're a fries? God's looking for people to say, Lord, thank you, and give it away. I was just thinking this morning when I was preparing for this, because I had no notes, I'm trying to memorize the outline. I'm showing off. No, I'm not. Anyhow, and I was thinking, I said, God, would I be willing to hand my guitars away? You know? Yeah. God, you know what? It's all yours. You know what happens when you let go of stuff? You become free. Now God is my sustenance. God, can I let go of those people? Can I let go of that security? Yeah. Yeah. God will let things come out of your life. Whoa, I feel insecure. Why? Because I was trusting in a person or a situation. I'm not going to trust that anymore. God, you're my source. God will make you a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great. You shall be a blessing. God says, you shall be a blessing. It's a command. You're supposed to be a blessing. I'm supposed to be a blessing. You should walk into a room and be a blessing. You should walk into the store and be a blessing. There's a long line. It's Christmas shopping. It's Black Friday. Some person's struggling. Hey, go ahead of me. You're going to make a left-hand turn. Hey, you go ahead of me. Be a blessing. Be a blessing. What would happen? You shall be a blessing. I will bless those. God, by the way, God will take care of you. Look at this. I know you don't like this, but listen to this. I will bless those who bless you, and I'll curse them who curses you. So God, you know what? God, you take care of these people. I'm going to be a blessing. God will be my defender. God will be my defender. And I will curse him who curses you. And listen to this now. Listen to this. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Now, did that happen? Yes. But this promise is just not for Abram who became Abraham. This promise is for you and I. We should be the best in art, literature, science, music, leadership, government. We should be the leaders, the best mechanics, the best janitors, the best stay-at-home moms or dads, the best PTA members, the best politicians, and in you, all the families of the earth will be blessed. Listen, I don't know about you, but we have an opportunity right here at Cornerstone. We're touching from Indonesia, right to Teen Challenge to Acts 4. We're touching the whole world. The world's a better place because we are blessed. Now listen to this. This is for us. We jump ahead to the New Testament. The Apostle Paul says this. And now that you belong to Christ, if you belong to Jesus Christ, listen to this. You are the true children of who? Abraham. Okay, what's the promises here for Abraham? Okay. What happens if you give your life to Christ? You're a child of Abraham. Look at your neighbor and say, you're a child of Abraham. Go ahead. All right. You are his heirs. It means the inheritance of Abraham's yours. Listen to this. And God's promise to Abraham belongs to the Jewish people, yes, but to who? You. What does that mean? Significant. It means that the Abrahamic, guys, listen. If you don't get this memorized, you need to. This is one of the hallmarks of my life now. I pray those almost every day over my children, over myself. Genesis 12, 2 through 3, that's your promise. Don't settle for anything else but God's best. Now, we're not being arrogant. No. We serve a God. If God can entrust you with his grace, if God can entrust you with finances, you better be able to give it away, just like Rick did with that money. He wasn't his. Your life is not your own. God wants to make us a blessing. He wants his church to affect the communities. He wants your schools to change, the town halls to change, the state house to change. He wants a nation to change. And it doesn't happen by electing somebody. It happens by electing yourself to follow Jesus Christ, to be his hands, to be his feet, and say, God, everything is yours. Nothing is mine. I'm blessed by you to be a blessing. If you and I will do that, the world will change. You won't need a politician. Why am I yelling? Because I want to get it through our thick skulls. God wants to bless you, to be a blessing. The world needs us. Why? Because we have God in us, the hope of glory. We need God, and he's waiting for someone to say, here am I, send me. Stop waiting for the evangelist. Stop waiting for somebody else. You are chosen. This is the truth, folks. I will make you a great church. I will bless Cornerstone. I will make Cornerstone great. And you will be a blessing to Cheshire. You will be a blessing to Prospect. You'll be a blessing to Southington, Middlebury, Southbury, whosoever's buried it is. And you should be a blessing across the world. I will bless those who bless the church. He'll take care of the other folks. Don't worry about it. God's got this one. And in you, in Cornerstone. And guess who's in Cornerstone? You are. This is not only for the nation of Israel. This is for our church. And this is for every single person. It's not about competing. It's about completing. Remember, give, and it will be given to you. These promises belong to you. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much that you are a God of grace and love and power. And Father, we forgive us, Father, for absolutely thinking that it's about us getting you to bless us so we can be better than our neighbor. You can bless us so we can parade around and drive something better and be in a better church, and our church does it right, your church doesn't. God forbid that we ever get that attitude. Lord, you blessed us to be a blessing. And I ask that Cornerstone Church would be known as a church that is so selfless and so full of love, and that every person finds their place. Every person is a blessing. Every person tries to out-bless each other. Lord, if we're going to compete, let us compete to bless each other. Father, I pray we would see this place explode with people giving their lives to you. Explode, Lord. That we would see people, Lord God, that would change their marketplace. We'd see missionaries come from this place. We see people, we see scientists come from this place. Musicians come to this place. Teachers come to this place. Mechanics come to this place. Father, that we would be your church. In Jesus' name. Amen. Listen. It says in Deuteronomy 15:15, end of that passage. Remember, you were once slaves in the land of Egypt, and the Lord your God redeemed you. That is why I'm giving you this command to be generous. Well, by grace, you have been saved through faith, and not of yourselves. It is a gift of God. Listen, God has saved you and I. You're not so special, but God is special. And because God is special, you're special. Listen, God has saved us for a reason. We're here to make a difference in the world. I can't find meaning in my life. Of course not. You're not designed to live for yourself. You're designed to live for God and to make a difference in the world. That's the reason Cornerstone exists. We want people to know God, to find the freedom he has for them, discover the purpose while they're alive, and then make a difference by giving grace and love to God. While you were yet a sinner, Christ died. In other words, God did it for you. You're not good enough, and neither am I. But God is good enough. Jesus is good enough. And because he's good enough, I'm good enough. Listen, you can go before God and say, I did all I could do. And God's going to say, I'm sorry, it's not good enough. The good news is, everyone is good enough if Jesus is their Lord and Savior. One day, you're going to have to face a God. One day, for those online, you're going to have to face a God. Are you ready to face God? I'm a pretty good person. It doesn't cut it. Only through Jesus do we have access to the throne of God. Only through Jesus do we find true prosperity. Only through Jesus do we find blessings. Cornerstone Church is all about Jesus. In fact, I'm going to start a new chant here at Cornerstone. Christ alone. I want you guys, how's it go again? Christ alone. Okay, why don't you say it? Christ alone is our cornerstone. Come on, say it again. Christ alone. Christ alone. Christ alone. Come on. Christ alone. Amen. Listen, if we'll stand on the rock of Christ, there's nothing we cannot do. But have you given your life to Jesus Christ? Let's bow your heads, please. I'm going to pray a prayer right now. And if you'll pray this prayer with your heart and your mind, then you can join the greatest adventure in history to be a part of God's kingdom. So otherwise, you cannot go before God. You want to pray after me, Lord Jesus, I thank you for dying on the cross for me. I ask you to forgive me of all of my sins. I receive your forgiveness. Thank you that what you did on the cross is enough. I receive it in Jesus' name. Thank you. I am now clean. And now I hand my life over to you. I declare you are God and I am not. Thank you, Lord. Fill me and bless me that I can be a blessing. In Jesus' name, amen. Every head bowed. Say, Pastor, I prayed that prayer for the first time, or I just, first time today, or I've made a recommitment. Let's just see a show of hands so I know better how to pray for you. Thank you. Anyone else this morning? Thank you, thank you, thank you. Anyone else? Thank you. Come on, everybody. Let's just thank God. Thank you. Come on. Let's thank God. Listen. Uncle Sam says, I want you. God says he wants you. Listen, you got a connection card in your bulletin, in your worship guide. If you don't have one, ask your neighbor. And I want you, if you've asked Christ to come in your life today, I want to ask you to do something. Just so we need to help track, okay, what's going on, so we can contact you. We won't bother you. We'll contact you. It says right here, my decision today, I'm committing my life to Christ or I'm renewing my commitment. And I want to be baptized. Please fill that out right now. Go ahead and do that. Can you do that, everybody? If you have a prayer concern, we called a couple of words of knowledge out last week for healing. If you got healed last week, can you write that so we know about it? Encourages other people. We need to be encouraging these last days, right? So could you do that, everybody? Okay, let's just fill out our connection cards right now. And as we're doing that, we're going to prepare ourselves to give through our tithes and our offerings. You know what? Together, we make a difference. Together, we can transform our lives, our communities, and yes, the world. So, Father, I pray you bless these tithes and offerings today. Go ahead, ushers. Let's go ahead and right now, as we give, this is part of worship. Now, a couple areas of, let's bring it down a little bit, a couple of areas of instruction. If you gave your life to Christ, we have a class every week at 9 o'clock during the first service in the conference room. It's called 10 Steps Closer to Christ. We'll give you a free book, and then this book will help you to take the steps closer to grow closer to God. It's a beginning, okay? Also, today, we have step 3 called Discovery, where you can find out how God has wired you. And I'm so pumped. We got Cynthia and Coleman doing an awesome job with personality, and we'll help you find how God's wired you. And then you can find your avenue in the church where you can start functioning as an army of believers going after the same thing. It's so cool, I can't stand it. Okay? So you can become a part of that. And we have extra food today, I think. So we got extra spaces. We always make extra food. You are welcome, and we have childcare. You have no excuse. Love to get you involved. Don't just come to church. Let's be the church. All right, everybody? Let's all stand as we conclude with our song. And if you need prayer, we have our prayer team coming down here this morning. Come on. Come on, one time. Let's Christ alone. Go out there and make a difference, everybody. Come on.